Nice job, Jason, on the O'Can. The next year is now.
Oh, thanks.
I told him you had a good.
The mic's so good. Oh, goodness.
Someone.
He's already here. Okay, I'll be done. Okay, thank you.
Stay indoors and keep warm.
There's a few versions.
I was looking at this.
Good morning, Councillor Wyatt.
Hot coffee. It's good to use them.
Okay, good morning. We'll commence the meeting of the Standing Policy Committee on Protection, Community Services, and Parks of Monday, January the 11th of 2016. Good morning. My name is Mike Pacticat. I'll be chairing today's meeting and pleased to be joined by my council colleagues, Councillor Russ Wyatt, Councillor Ross Eady, Councillor Jason Schreier, our clerk, Ms. Josie Marks, and members of our public service. Councillor.
The minutes of the past meeting.
Edie moves the minutes of the past meeting be taken as read and confirmed. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carry. Thank you, Councillor. Madam Clerk, do we have any delegations at all?
We have Sean Drain with the Winnipeg Soccer Federation. If need be, he's in the audience. He asked me to let you know.
Mr. Drain, do you wish to speak on the renaming? Sure. Yeah, just take a seat.
We need to suspend the rules. He registered this morning.
Move to suspend the rules. Okay. To hear a delegation.
Councillor Eady moves suspension rules. Right at the end, just because we're recording it, sir.
Yeah.
Good morning. Yeah. Your name,
okay.
Please.
My name is Sean Drain. I'm board member of the Winnipeg Soccer Federation, which has put forward a request that their consideration be given to the renaming of the Winnipeg Soccer Complex in honor of Ralph Cantafio. Ralph is known as the father of modern soccer in Winnipeg. He has been for over 50 years a major player in the soccer community. He's so widely respected and revered, not only in Winnipeg but across Canada. He has operated clubs. He has served on the boards of the Winnipeg leagues. He has served on the board of the predecessor of the current Winnipeg Soccer Federation. He was instrumental in the work that resulted in the achievement of the current Winnipeg Soccer Complex on Waverley, whenever the old Alexander Park complex close to Polo Park was closed down. He has operated the only professional soccer team to have played in Winnipeg, the Winnipeg Fury, which won the Meta Cup in 1996. And he is widely regarded, and as I said, revered as the father of modern soccer in Winnipeg. We think that the naming of the complex in his honor would be a recognition of the work that he has done in promoting soccer and furthering the game of soccer, not only in Manitoba and Winnipeg, but across Canada.
Thank you, Mr. Drain. Appreciate that. Any questions of delegation? Councillor Eady?
I'm just, where's the soccer complex?
The soccer complex is on Waverley.
Oh, that one.
Okay. It's almost at Wilkes. Okay. Wilkes and Waverley.
Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your time today.
Thank you.
Okay, we have reports. We've got three reports before us. The first one is the
Winnipeg Police Board 2016 Strategic Plan, and Don Norquay is in the audience.
Morning.
Morning. Mr. Chair.
here. Section 21 of the Winnipeg Police Board bylaw requires the board to prepare an annual strategic plan and submit it to council for information through this committee. The board prepared its first strategic plan. It is a five-year plan, updated annually, and it prepared its first one and completed it last May. So it was only a short period of time. It was published, and we had consultations on the update right afterwards. We're pleased, though, from the consultations that a substantial amount of the feedback was quite supportive of the strategic direction set out in the report. And really, there was not a lot of substantive change that was made. The board clarified a few areas, updated wording where initiatives were in the future and now are underway, and made a clear link between the operational side, where the business of implementing the strategic plans up to the service, and they are now producing an annual business plan to accord and implement the strategic plan. A lot of the input we received was more operational in nature and couldn't really be reflected in the strategic plan. So the public will see that in the services business plan, which is also now published. Our strategic plan is published on our website now, and again can be transmitted with your approval to council for information. I'm here for any questions. There is a report that's been published, the report that went to the Winnipeg Police Board when the report was adopted at the end of 2015. And, of course, the document is also published.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nurk. I appreciate that and all the work that you're doing along with the board. Any questions regarding the report? Councillor Wyatt?
Sorry, I was interrupted, Mr. Norquay, when you were speaking towards the end there. Something about something being included in another report?
We did have the report went to the board for approval in December and has been published. So I was just referring to the report that went to the board, which has been published with this agenda as well.
Which report is that?
The board of the Strategic Planning Committee report.
Oh, I see. Oh, is that what you're referring to? Okay. Because
yeah.
It was something, you were referring to something business being plan. Part of another a business plan and something.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, there's... there is a Winnipeg Police Service business plan that they now produce annually to show both the board and the public how they're planning to implement the strategic plan coming year.
Okay, so that's what you were referring to.
Yes.
Okay. In the strategic plan, Mr. Chairman, there's goal 3, effective and efficient services on page 15. You have you indicated the share of the overall city budget of the Winnipeg Police Service has gone from 20.7% to 26.4% over the past decade. That's the overall city budget as a percentage of that city budget.
Yes.
And then you indicate here that your intent is to hold the line in terms of increases in terms of the police service budget increase at or less inflation. Could you define inflation for us?
Well, the only intent there was the consumer price index.
Okay, so it is CPI?
Yes.
Okay. And is there, in terms of these efforts, we did do an operational audit or operational review called hired a company by the name of Matrix in the last 5 years. Are there findings built into this report? Because I didn't see much referral to them.
Most of the areas covered in the operational review were operational in nature and more for the service to implement. And in the reality of it is neither one of those reports really found substantive net savings. There are some areas that still could potentially be pursued and recommendations that are still under consideration, but unfortunately there was no magic in those reports.
Well, if I recall correctly, and I think what you said, the key word was net savings. There are savings identified in the matrix report. It's a question of whether or not you also want to make their enhanced service improvements as well that would net out to less of a savings than if you were just to pursue their savings options.
Yeah, the way that's been viewed, I think, is that the savings were somewhat related to the other changes that would cost money. So to gain the savings, you need to make the investments. It just made it generally more efficient and effective for the money that you're spending.
So is it fair to say that the WPS has buried the matrix report now, since there's nothing really referred to in this business plan?
Well, this is a strategic plan. I don't think it's fair to say that it's buried. No, I think it's still something that we're referring to for ideas on potential savings and ideas to follow up on. But again, I think more needs to be done to identify just where the savings might be found. I think it's important to note in the document on page 15. Third paragraph, the last sentence, salaries and benefits constitute roughly 85% of the service's annual operating budget, and they've been increasing at a rate that exceeds inflation. So I think that statement clearly indicates that it needs to be a very strong partnership between the board and the city administration to get the things between the two of bodies under control that can be under control. So to achieve the objective we're talking about here, increases at or less than inflation, does make certain assumptions regarding the future ability to get those kind of costs under control. Indeed, the projections have been in previous budgets that target would be achieved. But there are factors that are beyond the board's control.
Just on those points, moving away from a defined benefit plan to a defined contribution plan with regards to the Winnipeg Police pension plan, is that something that you foresee happening as a target in 2016?
Yeah, let me be clear that the board would take no position whatsoever on matters related to the collective bargaining. So it's really beyond the scope of the board. The board has no role in collective bargaining. The city is deemed to be the employer under the legislation, and the city has the express power and authority to set pay and benefits. So the board has no role in that. I think it would be... I think the board takes the view that it would be improper for it to take a position as a board on matters that would need to be negotiated freely and collectively bargained with the Winnipeg Police Association.
Okay. And I'll, is that basically in terms of just not just the issue of the pension, but all issues across the board in terms of the collective bargaining? Is that?
Well, when it comes to pay and benefits, that's what I was speaking to,
right,
as per the legislation. If there are operational matters, matters related to management rights that are currently in the collective agreement, if the board's advice was sought on operational implications of those kinds of provisions, the kind of additional costs that they'd impose, I'm sure the board would be happy to pass on its advice.
But otherwise, the board does not see itself being involved in those sorts of things. That's a city as an employer.
Simply as an advisory capacity in relation to provisions that relate to management rights and have operational cost implications for the service.
So
we could identify those and highlight them if the city is interested.
So I guess I come back to then, and what you had pointed out, Mr. Norquay, the fact that 85% of the service's annual operating costs are related to salaries and benefits. But then on page 17, that's on 15, you pointed out, on page 17, your goal is to have the police Winnipeg Police Services budget increases at or less the rate of inflation. How can you make that statement if on the one hand you're saying that you want to do this, on the other hand you're saying that you have nothing to do when it comes to, the board has no role or say when it comes to collective bargaining or how those things are managed. How can you make that statement?
It's a target, and many of the targets in this rely on partnerships and collaboration for their achievement, and that's clearly identified in the statements in the document throughout, that there needs to be this kind of partnership and collaboration.
So in terms of the operational side of it, which the board does have a role by the sounds of it, how, and we are known to be one of the less civilianized Winnipeg, one of the less civilianized police services in the country, according to the Matrix report, which was done a few years ago. What steps are going to be taken to increase the rate of civilianization with regards to the Winnipeg Police Service at the present time?
Section 17 does identify that the proportion of sworn officers to civilians is a measure. And there's to be a civilianization plan developed and completed by 2017. Again, that scenario where the collective agreement has a major role and constraints, and these things need to be negotiated with the union. So, again, it will take a level of partnership with the service, the union, and the city to achieve that kind of a target. And that's the national average of major Canadian cities would be the long-term goal identified in the strategic plan.
So civilianization is a long-term goal. So this is something that's not going to happen overnight is what you're telling me.
Well, we'll see in the plan in 2017 how quickly it can happen.
Because it seems to be directly linked to your ability to control your overall budget costs when you have officers doing the work that civilians could easily do.
Well, I think that may remain to be seen. The idea is to have the right people in the right jobs in the right number. And the plan will demonstrate what that is, whether or not this cost savings is debatable. For example, the smart policing initiative requires crime analysts, and those will need to be hired. Potentially some officers' positions could be converted to crime analysts. They don't need to be officers, they can be civilians, but there's no reason to suggest that crime analysts who are university-educated people and experts in the field, would necessarily be cheaper than sworn police officers.
What is the FTE today of the Winnipeg Police Service?
Well, I'd have to reference a document to get that exact number right now.
You don't have that
number
with
you? I don't have it memorized, no.
Oh, I see. So that we don't have the civilian FTE number for us, and we don't have the officer FTE number. Okay.
There is a report on the police.
No, I'm not asking you, Councillor. I'm asking the deputy director.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't have that number right at the tip of my tongue.
Could you take us through the process that led to the purchase of the gunship? Or gun tank, or whatever you want to call it.
The armored rescue vehicle.
Okay. How did that occur? How does that occur?
Councillor White, I don't know if that's part of this.
Well, it is part of the strategic plan under savings, Councillor. I mean, this is a cost which could have been deferred, and this could have saved the department $350,000. I'm curious on how this came about.
If
Mr. Norwood Quay doesn't want to answer the question, I understand. That's
probably take it under advisement.
I'm in your hands, Mr. Chair.
I don't know if that's not relevant to this report, Councillor Wyatt.
Well, it's just a recent matter which I thought speaks to the whole issue of trying to find efficiencies and savings, and was a discretionary expense which was made clearly not to the knowledge of the board, from the impression I get from reading the newspapers. I don't know if that's correct or not. That's why I wanted there to be an opportunity for the executive director of the board to be able to speak to that. So,
can I ask a question on that? Maybe we reframe the question, Councillor Wyatt, and ask the question. Out of the capital budget, which was submitted by the Winnipeg Police Board last year, was that armored vehicle in the capital budget for the Winnipeg Police Service?
Yes, no, that was not.
Right. Nor has it ever showed up in their capital budget, is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. In the report, it does refer to the cadets and the cadet program. We have the ability under the contract to go up to 200 cadet personnel. And at the present time, I believe we're in the range of about 50, I think partially funded by the provincial government, some of them, if not all of them. Are we right now the only thing preventing us from funding more cadets? Is it really a matter of financing? Is it a matter of cost versus a matter of contract? To take that number from 50 to the 200, which the contract allows us to do.
I believe that would be simply a matter of cost.
It's a matter of
cost and recruitment.
Cost and recruitment. So right now, so it's a question of us budgeting and allocating said budget towards it. What is the cost right now per cadet approximately annually?
I don't have that information at hand.
All right. Or the hourly cost?
I don't have that information.
Okay. I don't have any other questions. Maybe the other committee members do. Thanks.
Councillor Farr?
Thank you.
First of all, I truly appreciate Councillor Wyatt's line of questioning and Councillor Eadie's clarification on how to ask the question regarding this year's budget and expenses related thereto. Late last year, we had a presentation by you, Mr. Norquay, on this. I very much took a goal to engage communities to heart. I will be taking this to heart this year and as we approach budget time. These objectives, I think, are consistent with what our Chief Devon Kunis has been saying for years. Again, I repeat, he's the only person when I ran for city council just over a year ago, or almost a year and a half ago, I guess, he's the only person I quoted in my campaign material, and it had to do with raising the social consciousness of our community, and here I see it, and I think there is a real commitment by Winnipeg Police Services, by the Winnipeg Police Board, and I would hope that we as a council have some sort of harmony with this objective. I believe we do. How we go about this, we'll, in this year's budget round, we'll see how things go. Councillor White did raise issues about cadets and provincial government's involvement. I guess my question, Mr. Norquay, is when it comes to cadets, I understand the provincial government has been involved with financing new placements of police officers in Winnipeg, and is it just through cadets that the Winnipeg that the provincial government is involved with new placements, or is it directly through new placements of fully trained and graduated police officers?
There's a substantial contribution to the funding of quite a few sworn officer positions with the service that comes from the provincial government.
Now, and excuse me, sir, what is the difference between the report you brought to us and the presentation you made to this standing committee late last year, late November, early December, and what you're presenting today?
There's very little change in the strategic plan. Substantively, there's really no change. The strategic directions are virtually the same. There's some wording improvements, some updates, on statistics and so on. So it's, again, we've completed it close to halfway through the year last year. We are obliged to do an annual plan, so we're back with the update and would be hopefully on a proper timeline going forward.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Just in terms of, just some follow-up related and of course Bargany is a city, but in terms of trying to manage budget, is the board making progress in terms of reducing or keeping in check any other budget items outside of the collective agreement?
I think it probably wouldn't be fair to say that the board has, but the board has been holding the chief to account, and the chief has accounted for a number of savings areas over the last couple of years and has reported on those.
Yeah. In terms of, and this is again working with the chief, in terms of the civilianization of some of the employment positions, there have been over the last couple of years some civilianization, is that correct?
Yes, there has.
And you had indicated that a lot of them are sort of professional positions. These are positions that you basically have to pay some pretty good money then to have civilians do that work?
Yes, I mean, for example, one of the latest is the manager of human resources has been civilianized. So. Positions like that as well. It's not all just sort of clerk kind of duties.
In terms of the two reports that were referred to, the matrix report and that, I guess a good portion of those recommendations that came out of the report are directly related to collective bargaining, is that right?
There's a significant number of them that can't be implemented under the current terms of the collective agreement. And it did expressly, the reports expressly noted that and recommended changes be negotiated.
Has the board had an opportunity to evaluate the business plan against the strategic plan so far, like how it's to proceed? Or?
Well, actually, that we have the board has a quarterly meeting with the chief, and the first quarterly meeting since the preparation of the business plan is this month, so mid-month. It had to be postponed from December, so that is occurring later this month.
Great. Thank you, Councillor
Edie.
Councillor Wyatt?
Yeah, thank you. Just to follow up on my previous question, Mr. Darkway, thank you for your time. The so if I understand correctly, that when it comes to collective bargaining and issues such as pension reform, that is the mandate or the responsibility solely of the mayor and the Executive Policy Committee and Council, by and large?
Yes. Anything to do with pay and benefits are set by council.
Okay. And as the board, can the board give recommendation, though, through the chair to the mayor and to EPC with regards to those matters?
It would be my advice to the board that they should be very reluctant to intervene on a matter of pay and benefits. I would also advise them that they could give advice on operational improvements that might be constrained by the collective bargaining, collective agreement terms.
So if there is pension reform, for example, going from a defined benefit plan to a defined contribution plan, that would be something that the mayor, EPC, and council would have to spearhead. By and large, there would not be. It's not something that we would have to wait from the board to hear from on in regards to that matter.
Absolutely not. That is something not only council and EPC would have to spearhead. They would be the sole decision makers in as part of the collective bargaining responsibilities.
Unless the other side of the table came forward with a suggestion on that, which they have a right to do too, right?
Right.
Yeah, okay, no, fair enough. And the cadet funding, the cadets is just, I think, just a wonderful program. And when Keith McCaskill had negotiated that into the contract a number of years ago, and I remember chatting with the former chief about it, and it just allows for the ability for so many things in terms of increased presence, in terms of having young people being part of the service and having future avenues for individual recruitment into the rank and file of the Winnipeg Police Service, especially at this time when many of them are, you know, hitting ages close to retirement. Is that something that in terms of your budget submission to EPC, which I know you do, is that something that you've included increased funding for cadets through your budget submission?
The board has relied on the chief to provide advice as to the ideal number of cadets given the responsibilities that they can undertake. The board supported that funding requirement. I don't believe that there was a significant increase in the last request, but
I understand those things are also kept confidential because they are a budgetary matter, and those budget matters tend to be kind of guarded until the budget's actually released, so I can appreciate your answer. The other matter that I alluded to, but I'm not going to name it now because I got the chairman going, but I'll just say it's my understanding that safeguards have been put in place now in terms of the board, in terms of any type of capital purchase over $100,000 that is required to now come before the board of the police board. Is that correct in terms of capital purchases, or at least advising the board?
Well, there's been preliminary discussions with the chief and the board on that question, and that is a matter for discussion at the upcoming meeting with the chief that was postponed from December to be held later this month.
Okay. And Mr. Norke, would it be possible if we could get, maybe not today, but for our next meeting, a listing of our FTEs pertaining to officers and FTEs pertaining to civilians for the Winnipeg Police Service, just so we could have a comparison, since it is budget related.
Yeah. That's why I'm going to advise that the police.
Well, they don't report to the standing committee. For this annual matter, it's specifically written that the police board reports to council via the standing committee. Other issues, the police no longer report to the standing committee on protection.
No, I want the overall, Mr. Chairman, of where we stand in terms of, because I think it's pertinent to the report. If you read the report and you talk about the need to civilianize and you talk about the need to keep your costs at rate of inflation when it comes to personnel, knowing the FTEs of the officers and knowing the FTEs of civilians and then the ratio therein overall as we stand today, and maybe even a chart showing the past, I think would be very useful for the city. Is that something that would be...
Let me take that advisement to Councillor, and we could always bring it up in another meeting.
Yeah, I mean, it would be something I would be looking for in the budget. I'm assuming the budget coming forward for the city of Winnipeg, that's something that I think should be included in the budget if the budget chair or the finance chair is serious about controlling costs in this area. And I know he is. So just on another matter, Mr. Chairman, I'm curious to know why a member of the police board has been suspended and why there's an investigation ongoing when this individual member of council has not been charged with any charge that I'm aware of.
I have to leave the room on this question.
I'm just on that line of questioning, Councillor Wyden.
Should be discussed here. We have no jurisdiction. The Standing Committee doesn't have jurisdiction over this matter, so it's no.
If I may ask another way,
in general, and you know, I do enjoy the explanations that we get from the police board and Mr. Norquay. Why would there be, in general, if ever, an investigation when there are no charges?
Once again, I would say that the matter is not on the agenda.
I'm not speaking of any matter, but I'm just wondering if that is...
You could probably telephone call Mr. Norquay and get the answer to that question, Councillor.
Okay. But I'm glad that the question was raised here at this committee.
I can, you know, I appreciate the board has they have board members signing an agreement in terms of joining the committee, and you know, I guess there's a fine line between upholding the rules of your committee and kind of a. What could be best described as, especially since there's no charges involved, that it kind of starts to borderline on a McCarthy witch hunt. So,
Mr. Chair, I would, of course, not be prepared to provide any comment on a specific case, but for the information of the councillors and the education of the public, I'd be happy to describe the framework as it exists relating to obligations of police board members. The Police Services Act, which is provincial legislation, requires the Manitoba Police Commission to establish a code of ethical conduct for police board members. The Police Commission has done so. The Act also requires, as a provincial legislative requirement, for board members to comply with the Code of Ethical Conduct. The Police Commission also has established a policy and procedure manual for the boards, police boards in Manitoba, and that policy and procedure manual requires that all police board members are required to assist the board in coming to its decisions. The Code of Ethical Conduct itself prescribes a role for the board in its enforcement. So the board members have a duty not only to comply with the code themselves, but to ensure that all of their fellow board members are in compliance with the code. So it's their responsibility under the legislative framework, Police Services Act, Policy and Procedure Manual, the Code of Ethical Conduct for police board members. When there is some question about a member's conduct and compliance, they're obliged to inquire into that conduct and make a determination as to whether or not the member has breached the Code of Ethical Conduct. And these matters go far beyond sort of standard criminal charges. Certainly, if someone is charged with an offense, it's a breach of the code, but there's many other kind of situations where the code might be contravened. So, those documents are published and can be referenced. The code is Policy and Procedure Manual is available. It's the Code of Ethical Conduct is an appendix to that, and the councillors can have a look at that and see the broad scope of the board's responsibilities and board members' responsibilities under the code.
Thank you very much, Councillor. Wyatt?
I guess, is this, because the board is relatively new, is this the first time that there has been a suspension of a board member under the Code of Ethical Conduct?
To be clear, the use of the word suspension, in my view, is not appropriate. A suspension implies an actual decision to suspend. There's been no such decision. The Code of Ethical Conduct, by its terms, requires members to refrain from participating on the board, carrying out their responsibilities as board members in the course of an inquiry and investigation into their conduct.
Is this the first time that this has occurred at the board?
Excuse me, clarification, whether it's been a suspension or an absence from meeting.
In terms of Mr. Northway's definition of what he's just indicated.
There was a board member who was charged with an offense and was afforded a leave of absence from the board so that they could be in compliance
They were charged with an offense?
They were charged.
I see. That happened in the previous term?
Yes.
Okay. But in this case, the individual in question has not been charged in any, to your knowledge?
Well, I really wasn't prepared to talk about an individual case, but as I noted earlier, it doesn't matter whether or not a person's been charged. As to whether or not they breached the Code of Ethical Conduct. There are other ways of contravening the code that do not involve criminal charges.
So the Code of Ethical Conduct, just so I understand this correctly, right? So now, what is the process here, Mr. Northway, for this? Where does this go? How does this work in terms of that? So right now you have this, you're having an investigation. Do you as the board have the power to remove? You're appointed by counsel, are you not?
No, and the Code of Ethical Conduct itself is clear on this. It spells out what the board may do. Okay. The board may, if it makes a determination that a member has contravened the code, the board is required to record that determination in its minutes and may call the member before the board for the purpose of reprimanding the member. The board may ask the member to resign, or the board may request counsel to revoke the appointment.
And I'm assuming the board would do the latter in the event that the member refused to resign.
If that was the determination of the board, that was the appropriate thing to do in the particular case, yes.
It's my understanding, and correct me if I'm wrong, that the chair of the board withdrew himself from these proceedings?
Again, I think you should ask the questions about that of the chair, not me.
Okay. I was just curious that he would withdraw himself from the proceedings. That the only reason he would is if he knew that it was already going to be going to council for a vote.
Councillor Shire?
Just clarification on that. Would you consider that there has been a reprimand that has taken place right now by the board?
Well, certainly not. There's been no determination by the board.
So there's no reprimand at this time, for the record.
The board, well, just again, I didn't want to talk about a specific case.
You can't talk about a specific case.
I do have fair enough, Chair Factor Ken. Now, I do have, again, just for the record, just for public understanding, is it not true that anyone in this country can be under investigation at any time without any charges? Just so we have an understanding of what has taken place over the last 15 minutes, this gives some clarification as to what we're dealing with. Anybody can be under investigation at any time without any charges laid. Is that?
Thank you for that, Councillor Schreier. Any other questions?
Just one, because I'm trying to understand the process. And so the deliberations that will be undertaken at the board pertaining to this matter, are they done in a public forum or are they behind closed doors? How is that done?
The board views proceedings under the Code of Ethical Conduct as private matters. The only obligation on the board is to make its determination public through its minutes.
Through once the decision is made?
Yes. And the board does accept a duty of procedural fairness in dealing with matters under the Code of Ethical Conduct.
Thank you, Mr. Merkley.
Thank you, Mr. Merkley.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, members, we're looking for a motion to forward the information to council for information.
So moved.
By Councillor Wyatt. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. On the renaming Winnipeg Soccer Complex to Ralph Cantafio Soccer Complex, I had a quick discussion with Councillor Orlico. Who indicated that he's prepared to provide the necessary funds from his land dedication. And to facilitate that, it's my understanding that the department would then apply regarding the said funds to a community committee. So in that respect, I guess, Madam Clerk, we could...
You could approve it subject to land dedication approval by the City Centre Community Committee.
Councillor Edie? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Thank you. On item number 3, Recreation Facilities Master Plan Update.
We didn't have time to meet about this, Mr. Chairman. Can we lay it over for another month?
Okay.
If you don't mind?
Fantastic.
Okay.
Councillor White moves it over to our next meeting. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
Is
there any other items? Councillor Shardy, which is the Consent Adjournment.
Some.
All those in favor?
Thank you, Councillors.
Thank you very much. Thank you, members.
I need to get another cup of coffee.